Okay, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This is Bayo with another episode of Sun Chasing Success. And today I have a very special guest from Rio de Janeiro here in Brazil. She's a certified tour guide and travel agent, and she's been promoting the African legacy experiences in Rio since 2013. She graduated in arts education from the Federal University of Espírito Santo, and she has a master's degree in community arts management at the University of Oregon in the United States. Her whole life has been dedicated to acknowledging her roots through educational actions and projects. And an essential part of her work is to meet people from all over parts of the world in Brazil in order to share experiences and positive actions and best practices. So I'm really excited about this one. Her website is www.rioencantos.com. That's rioencantos.com. And she can be found on Instagram at Rio EnCantos. And without any more, Kelly de Oliveira Tavares, welcome.
Oh, thank you very much, Bayo, for the opportunity to be here at your podcast and program. I'm very grateful and honored for that invitation. And well, I'm here to tell stories and to share and learn. And I've been here working a long time already with education and always involved with social causes. That's my drive and my motto throughout my life. So if I run any type of business, every time I'll be engaged with positive actions for change, for reparations of, you know, to catch up with the mistakes of the past.
Wow.
That are unfortunately being repeated now, and we have a lot of work to do.
Wow.
And traveling is also a political action.
Absolutely.
With purpose or responsibly.
I agree with you, and that's why when I saw your particular site and your Instagram and everything, I was like, wow, this is exactly what I had in mind with my blogs and my my podcasts and the things that I wanted to share. And there's so many questions I have, but I guess the first question is, what led you to this line of work, and how was your life growing up? You grew up in Rio or another part?
Yes.
Grew up in
I
Rio?
Was born in the port area where the Black History Walks take place.
Mm-hmm.
And being born in that area with a population of mainly Black people, I was able to come across different situations that I started to ask about my own identity. Like, wow. Could be like prints of art or the situation that our population finds itself, like the difficulties and the way we live, mm-hmm. the very way we handle when we drive our lives, like very community based because of low resources that mm-hmm. we have to share, and coming and growing in a family where people always helped each other, and like adopted cousins, adopted friends, and our house was small, very open, always open for yeah. those who need it. And I found out later that it's actually a tradition of that place.
Mm-hmm.
And when and through research, you find that what your family brings and carries is actually something that was built on the past
wow.
of our ancestors. So, and then I found out that through research and all the finds and discoveries that we had here with the archaeological sites in that region, just will drive me more and more to learn more and understand why I am how I am and why I need to keep fighting even stronger and mm-hmm. like bringing people together to stop fighting against each other and mm-hmm. to unite in order to bring awareness for responsible traveling, for example, because we need to start supporting the ones who really need the support to tell their narratives, to show you real Brazil, the real Rio, mm-hmm. and these kind of things, you know.
Wow. And now what part of Rio was that you grew up in, specifically like the neighborhood?
Yes. Yeah, so my first years, like until my fifth year old, it was in the port area of Rio.
Oh, the port area.
Where there's okay. The port area. It's like the docks area.
Ah, okay.
So there is a long history because, for example, there is where is located the UNESCO World Heritage Site for the transatlantic slave trade.
Wow.
And that was not listed as such, recognized as such in 2017, in the middle of the year. And just to give you an idea that in that port, that's now this archaeological historic window there for people to see, arrived more than 1.5 million African people from different parts of Africa.
Wow. And from what I remember, from what I read, I think total in Brazil was more initially than the United States. It was about 4 million that ended up here in Brazil.
Transatlantic slave trade. Well, it's 12 million, it's estimated.
Was it 12 million? Wow, even the numbers were actually more than what I had been reading, and maybe that's been obscured as well.
Exactly.
That's
so, and these are the kind of things that when you go into documents and keep researching, so science and history is this science that we always confront. Different findings will bring different data. So it's very complicated sometimes to specify a number if I don't dive into the statistics all the time, because this also changes. Like the estimates for the slave cemetery, for example, in the IPN, that's today the Institute of New Blacks, they're at the same region. Mm-hmm. So you have estimates for 50,000 people being from their bodies being thrown on that mass grave. So this is like a huge genocide that is attached to the slave trade in Brazil of more than 300 years of slavery.
Wow. Yeah, this is a very powerful. Having grown up in the United States, I understand that there's a lot of information that is not clear in the textbooks and the schooling and the process. So it's very interesting to be here and see how African culture was formed here in Brazil, how some of the things were translated from West Africa into the culture here. So would you say when you were talking about your family life, when you were growing up, obviously as a kid, maybe you associated it some things negatively, some things positively, but then later you found out that this is a part of something cultural. What was it that you saw in African culture that was part of your upbringing in Rio?
Wow, that's such a deep question. Thank you.
I tried.
Wow. The very soul. So let's go deep then.
Okay, let's go deep.
Let's get the same depth level that we are working here now.
Yeah, yeah.
So let's bring to ancestors spiritual guidance. Mm-hmm. Let's go to the Orishas.
Okay.
Now I'm getting goosebumps here.
Okay. Hey, you know.
It's just, you know.
It's spiritual. Part of the culture, yes.
I can feel it.
Wow, yeah. That's
so I can feel it like that. I'm one of the messengers and warriors of this fight, and I have a mission.
Wow.
So, and that's it. Wherever I go.
And that's beautiful, you know. That's the whole thing is when we were able to converse like this, even over technology with space and time, you can see that feeling. And you'll see with some of the other guests that I've had on the show, it's the same thing. It's amazing. Yeah. So, okay. So this family vibe there. So what are those things? Because I've noticed being here, right, from the United States, the emphasis that Brazilians have on family. Has been very eye-opening for me, whether it's birthday parties from a very young age, whether it's traveling together to different places, having coffee 3 times a day together, or doing all these things, you know. What does that do for us as human beings, and what did it do for Africans back then, and what does it do for us now?
African... tradition from different peoples from Africa, like the respect for the older people and the respect for teaching the younger ones to keep the generation and the knowledge flowing around that. So, and also the idea of an expanded family. So the way we do our we welcome people in our house, for example, is such in such a friendly way that our neighbors, like here, there is a back patio in my house, uh-huh. and a building there with many windows. So the neighbor there on the, from those windows, some of them, they can come to me and say, "Hey, Kelly, how are you? Let's go. Let's have a beer. Let's." Oh, they come to my our window. I live in the first floor. They say, "Hey, let's have a coffee." Now with the pandemics, we're closed for five months. So our friends and neighbors, they're missing that. They say, "Oh my goodness, let's do something." But we are stuck at home. But our house is open. It's a multinational, multicultural house. Wow, that's how we built up, especially after I traveled and I lived in the U.S. Mm-hmm. I was part of an international cultural service program with students from all over the world in that group. And we learned a lot about intercultural relationships and exchange. So I realized that the way we lived here already with our local families and extended families, I could no longer live without the diversity of incorporating other nations to be with us. So I started this, like welcoming people and opening for Airbnb so we could receive people from different parts, and then opening the travel agency and bringing people together. So that's just like the way it is now.
Right.
A very extended family.
Yeah.